This is February the 5th, 2010. We're in the law offices of Bill Swan in Phoenix, Arizona, and Bill has agreed to sit down with us for an oral history for the Colorado River Board of California. So Bill, thanks very much for meeting with us today. The interest here, we're in Phoenix and you're an attorney and we're in Arizona. We really want to talk about Colorado River issues as they affect California mostly, and it's hard not to draw Arizona, Nevada, and other states into that discussion, sure. And that's fine. But let's start this conversation by finding out how you got into water and perhaps how you got into law in the first place.
Okay.
You're an Arizona native. What's the story?
Okay. I started out going to law school in California, in San Diego. So I was comfortable with a number of different jobs over there that I did during law school. I worked a lot during law school, and I did all kinds of things with the Attorney General's office and civil litigation and divorces and criminal law and everything else. But I went away, even though I had job offers, I went away dissatisfied and saying, you know, I really would like to do something different. And a gal that I went to law school with ended up as one of the special attorneys that they hire at the Department of Interior in Washington each year, special new graduates. They have a program. And so I talked to her somewhat frequently about Department of Interior and what she was doing and the interest of her work and all of that. And she said a number of times, there's an office of attorneys in Phoenix. You ought to pay attention to that office and you ought to see whether or not they've got something going. So she called me one time and said they have an opening for an attorney in Phoenix.
What year would this be?
And this would be about 1979, okay. Something like that. And so I went and applied for it, but they hired someone else because they needed some specialization, if I remember correctly. But then and I was working for a Superior Court judge at the time as a clerk. And they called back later and said, we have another position open. Would you please come down and talk to us? And I did, and I was hired by the field solicitor's office in Phoenix for the U.S. Department of the Interior. Now, this particular office, in every office, wherever it is, Sacramento or Portland or Denver or whatever, they have jurisdiction given the sort of territory of the agencies that they represent. Ordinarily, BLM is a state-by-state operation. So if you are in Arizona, you represent the Arizona BLM.
The Bureau of Land Management.
Bureau of Land Management. The Bureau of Reclamation, you go with the territory. And here, the territory of the Bureau of Reclamation was the lower basin of the Colorado River. So they were out of Boulder City, Nevada, having jurisdiction over everything below Glen Canyon Dam. So it covered the states of Arizona, California, Nevada, and of course, the Republic of Mexico. And so that was the jurisdiction of that client. The jurisdiction for the Bureau of Indian Affairs for that particular office of attorneys was the jurisdiction of the Phoenix Area Office of BIA, which was Nevada, part of California, Utah, and Arizona. So it was gigantic. I mean, the BIA had jurisdiction over like 50 Indian reservations. It was huge. And then there was the Fish and Wildlife Service and the National Park Service. I ended up doing work for all of those agencies from one time or another. But I had a specific focus early on in water rights. And the water rights for the Indian tribes in this area, and there were beginning to be heated up controversies over the water rights. And this whole idea of having water adjudications in the states was just getting started, and some actions were being filed in Arizona to start adjudications on various watersheds. So we really had to get to know the Indian reservations on those watersheds and what kinds of rights they would have. We had to understand the Federal Reserve Rights Doctrine and all of that stuff. So for a long time, I was involved with water rights for all of those agencies, BLM, Park Service, BIA, Bureau of Reclamation, all of them, trying to figure out their water rights, how they would fit into these adjudications, what kinds of claims we would file for them, how we would litigate everything, and it just went on and on. Before I get into the Bureau of Reclamation specifically, the importance of the BIA work was that it took me into a whole realm of water rights where I had understand the water of the Southwest, because these reservations cover all that territory. You have the reservations over on the Colorado River, and we still had some litigation going on for Arizona versus California, so I had to understand that. The reservations in Arizona, the reservations in Nevada, and all of that. So it was a great education in regard to water rights and water law. About the same time, the Central Arizona Project was being constructed. So they were just beginning the pumping plant out of Lake Havasu and over the mountains and the canal over to Phoenix and then eventually the canal down to Tucson. And it took them, since 1977 or 78 until 1997 or 78 or 98 or something like that to complete the project or to almost complete it. So it took a long time, and there was a lot to do with that as well. There were all the contracts with CAWCD, the Central Arizona Water Conservation District, the subcontracts with the users of water, how we were going to deal with the Indian reservations and their allocations, allocations for people who were away from the river and weren't away from the canal and weren't connected to the canal physically. So there was an awful lot to do with the CAP, the Central Arizona Project. About that time,
we're talking in late 70s?
Late 70s, early 80s. About that time, there was an office of the solicitor in Boulder City, Nevada. So the Boulder City office of the Bureau of Reclamation, the lower regional office, and you've talked to Bob Johnson, he used to be the regional director there. Lower Colorado River region had their own lawyers in Boulder City. They had two lawyers there, if I remember correctly. One of them retired, and that left one guy, and the Washington office of the solicitor's office decided to close that office. So they moved the one guy to Phoenix. But he was old enough where he was getting close to retirement, and so I think he worked for about 4 years, and he was primarily involved with the CAP and the structure of the CAP and the contracting for the CAP and all of that. And there was an awful lot of work, as you can imagine, for the building of the CAP. All the construction contracts had to come through our office and be approved and everything else. So this guy worked for about 4 years and then he retired. Now they didn't any longer have a lawyer up in Boulder City. They were totally reliant upon Phoenix. They needed a lawyer who was going to focus on their matters, primarily for the lower Colorado River region, and they landed on me because I was the guy doing water rights at the time in that office. So I ended up having to get to know the business of the Bureau of Reclamation when it came to Arizona's entitlement, Nevada's entitlement, California's entitlement, the Republic of Mexico issues with the treaty and that sort of thing. So I had to become a student of the law of the river. And that probably took me from about 1985 to 1995 to really understand it real well. And they just had all kinds of issues. I mean, they would have issues with Arizona and the CAP. They would have issues with Nevada and their rights. They would have issues in California with their rights and inter-California disputes, or intra-California disputes. Sometimes issues under the treaty with Mexico and that sort of thing. And they would come to me largely for those problems. Every now and then we would have another attorney work on some issue if I was too busy or whatever, but I largely did that work. So it all depended upon what was going on in each state for the type of issue. But to focus a little bit on California, one of the things that was going on at that time was that IID was in the process of talking to San Diego about, they were talking to MWD about the transfer of a water supply. And there was dispute about what law controlled that transfer. And the two parties just butted heads on it and couldn't agree. And the basic issue is this. MWD takes the position that the river is totally federalized. that the federal government controls everything having to do with the river and the states don't have any role whatsoever. IID takes the view that the federal government has a limited role in certain areas, and then in other areas the state law controls. And IID took the view that the state law controlled water transfers and thought that they had to go through the State Water Resources Control Board and through other processes to make the transfer work. So this was an issue that kept going back to the Bureau of Reclamation because these two parties couldn't get it together, and there had already been proceedings in front of the state board that I'm sure you're aware of where IID was accused of wasting water when the salt and sea got large enough to flood some farmlands. And so some farmers brought issues
in. We're talking about the Elmore suit.
The Elmore suit in the State Water Resources Control Board and then in court litigation. And IID, it was ruled, was not using water efficiently, and it ought to conserve some water, and it ought to find a partner to do that, and so that the partner could help pay for the conservation and they could transfer the water.
That ruling was in state court, California state court.
That was in California state court process, or state administrative and judicial.
Right.
So because of that, they were trying to do this water transfer. But they got hung up on this jurisdictional issue. So the solicitor asked that I draft an opinion on that matter, and he assigned the associate solicitor for water and science, or whatever it's called, the one who has jurisdiction over the Bureau of Reclamation, to coordinate with me on that. And so I started drafting this opinion, and it turned out to be a long process. I mean, it's a complicated area of the law, and it took about 80 pages or 90 pages to try and explain it. And in a great nutshell, what it is, it has to do with the priority of federal law over state law, and when that's the case. And in some situations, federal law totally preempts state law and covers a field. And a good example is the regulation of nuclear power. The federal government largely controls that, and there isn't any room for states to legislate in that area. And that's because they want uniform policies in regard to something as important as the development of nuclear power. But in other areas, the federal government will oftentimes legislate, but they won't fill the area of regulation. They will only partly do something, and then the rest is left to the states to control. I think an example might be air quality and that sort of thing. There's a lot that the states do in regard to air quality, and the federal government even recognizes in legislation that the states have a role. But in the Colorado River, the Congress has never made it clear. But in Arizona versus California, there's some confusing Supreme Court decision in Arizona versus California. There's confusing language because at some point it says in these areas of contracting and deciding who gets water, there is no place for state law. And then in another place in the opinion, it says the states are allowed to do certain things according to this section of the Boulder Canyon Project Act, and what other things the states can do, we will decide another day. So they leave the door open that there are things that the states can do. So I had to decide this basic issue of preemption. What was the extent of federal law, and what was the area of state law that could be covered by state legislation? And to put it in a nutshell, I ruled that part of the field was preempted. The area of contracting for water rights and deciding who within a state would get water rights and, that didn't have present perfected rights, the contractual rights that they were giving out to parties on the river. Those areas were preempted. The states didn't have any jurisdiction. But in other areas, the states did have jurisdiction in deciding what's a beneficial use, in deciding whether or not there is reasonable beneficial use, as the state board had done with IID. And the federal government didn't object to that process. In other areas, interstate banking or intrastate banking of federal project water and that sort of thing. The states can legislate in those areas. So I had a draft opinion that had been worked on by the associate solicitor, and it basically ruled, as I will say it now, against MWD and in favor of IID. And the parties were still negotiating, and as I understand the story, an assistant secretary who was assistant secretary of jurisdiction over the Bureau of Reclamation was in contact with both parties, IID and MWD, and called MWD one day and said, we have a preliminary opinion that doesn't go your way. And so thereafter, shortly, they reached an agreement on a water transfer, and that's what ended up with the transfer of about 105,000 acre feet from IID to MWD. It was the first big agriculture to urban transfer.
Is it fair to say that that opinion covered any federal water? I mean, it wasn't specific to the Colorado River or to the lower basin.
It was specific to the Colorado River.
It was, okay.
Yeah.
And was it specific to the lower basin or to
specific to the lower basin, yeah.
Okay.
Because under what it really is an interpretation of the Boulder Canyon Project Act of 1929 and what Congress intended. And the Boulder Canyon Project Act really legislates only in regard to the lower basin. The two basins are different, and let's go off on that for just a second.
Okay.
The lower basin is really regulated by the federal government, and the secretary has a very prominent role in not only managing the reservoirs, but deciding who gets water rights and contracting for the water and that sort of thing. In the upper basin, things are handled much differently. All of the water rights are given out by the state engineers for each of those states. So the federal government doesn't contract for rights from those reservoirs, even though they're federal reservoirs. They're handled by the states up there. The government runs the dams, but an awful lot of what goes on in the upper basin is controlled by the four states of the upper basin. So they're always very careful to point out that there's a difference between the upper basin and the lower basin, and that they, as states, are not so constrained by federal law in the upper basin as we are in the lower basin.
Why do you think that dichotomy exists?
I don't know that I have a good answer for that, other than the fact that when Congress first legislated on the Colorado River, the focus was the lower basin. The focus really was, and this gets back a little bit to IID. If you want to go back to the sort of fundamental history of the law of the river, it's important to go back to about 1905, 1910, 1915, that region, because there were two things going on. Number one, the lower basin was increasing in population, and that frightened the upper basin, because the law that was assumed to apply even to an interstate stream was the law of prior appropriation, which was the law in all of the states. But they didn't know for sure whether or not that applied to an interstate stream. Certainly we knew that on the Stanislaus in California, prior appropriation was the law. He who got to the water first got the better right, as long as they perfected that right. And then juniors would come along later, and in times of shortage, the junior guys would get shut off first and the senior guys would have water. That was the law in the West, but they didn't know if it applied to interstate streams. But the upper basin was concerned that it would, and they were watching downstream, and they were seeing that the Imperial Irrigation District was growing like crazy and was irrigating 100,000 acres, then 200,000, then 300,000, then 400,000, and they had plans for a district that was 900,000 acres in size. So it could have appropriated the entire river. And Palo Verde and Coachella and the growing city of Los Angeles, which had eyes on an aqueduct from the river. And then there was the Yuma irrigation lands and the Indian reservations along the river. And all of this stuff was going on in the lower basin that frightened the upper basin. The second thing that was going on was floods. It flooded a lot in the early part of the last century.
The Colorado River.
The Colorado River. It flooded numerous times, and it would flood out dams like Laguna Dam, which was the predecessor to Imperial Dam. And it obviously created the flood in 1905, where it breached its channel and flooded into the Salton Sea and created the Salton Sea. So there were significant floods, and the Gila River in Arizona was flooding, and the Colorado was flooding. And so these interests in the south part of the river, primarily IID is the biggest gorilla down there, but also Palo Verde and also the Yuma area irrigation districts were pushing for legislation that would regulate the river and primarily build a big dam somewhere up in the area of Black Canyon near Las Vegas. And also IID wanted a canal that would be all in America and didn't have to go down through Mexico. their canal in the early part of the IID development took off from the river near Yuma, traversed the land gravity-wise through Mexico, and then back up into the United States and into the Imperial Valley, and they had to share water with Mexico, and it was a constant hassle, and there were problems with silting and all of that. So with these two forces in place, population and flooding, there was impetus for a piece of legislation that would legislate in regard to the lower basin, Arizona, California, Nevada, create a dam and regulate the river. It didn't have anything to do with the upper basin, and the upper basin didn't want it to extend up there. So they took a stand at that point that there were really two different basins. And of course, in 1922, in the development of the Colorado River Compact, that's when the two basins were created. The upper basin, 4 states, and the lower basin, 3 states, and then it divided the water half and half to each basin. It was between 1922 and 1929 that they haggled over the Boulder Canyon Project Act and what it would be like and what it would say and whether or not it would quantify the water rights for Arizona, California, Nevada, and that sort of thing. All of that was argued in that 7-year period and went back and forth between the states. And Arizona particularly didn't like the federalization of the river in the area because they thought they had control of the Colorado River and at least half of it, and they didn't want a dam on their half of the property and that sort of thing. They were very, very difficult, and they took lawsuits to the Supreme Court, I think, 3 times against California and the United States to try and stop development of the river, and they lost every time. So we all know about Arizona versus California in the 60s, but there were earlier Supreme Court decisions as well where Arizona litigated about the river and federal legislation and lost every time.
Were those linked to the famous Arizona v. California in 1964?
No.
They're just totally separate, events.
Okay. Totally separate events. So anyway, they finally reached agreement on the compact in 1922, which basically saved the upper basin from this idea that the river could be appropriated totally by the lower basin. And there had been a decision in the Supreme Court, I think it was Wyoming versus Nebraska or something like that, that said that the prior appropriation doctrine applied to interstate streams. So IID could have by itself appropriated most of the river. And as a matter of fact, an interesting little footnote of history is that in about 1924, IID sued Colorado. And here's a little irrigation district in California suing the state of Colorado because they were trying to finish a tunnel from the west slope to the east slope to transfer Colorado River water to the east side where all the people are. And IID sued to stop it, saying, we've appropriated that water. It's our water. So it was an incredible feat of chutzpah for this district to say, I don't care that the water is 1,400 miles from my district. I've appropriated it. It's mine. It flows down to me, and I've done the appropriation under state law, and it belongs to me. It doesn't belong to you, and I don't care if it comes from your state. Now, why did IID do that? I'm not sure they did it in order to try and win and enjoin the construction of the tunnel and the aqueduct. They did it in order to get Colorado to be more supportive of the Boulder Canyon Project Act and to say to Colorado, you know, you've got the compact now, you have your upper basin entitlement, and you can grow into that entitlement without fear of prior appropriation by the lower basin. But we need to have this act passed. And so they were maneuvering to get all of the states in support of the passage of the Boulder Canyon Project Act. And they finally worked out all the terms of the act and the building of Boulder Dam and the building of the All-American Canal, and all of that was put into legislation in 1929.
In Colorado, was that the beginning of the Big Thompson project?
I don't think it was Big Thompson. I think it was another earlier project, and Big Thompson came along a little bit later. I think Big Thompson was in the 40s, if I remember correctly. But it was, there are about a half a dozen or 8 or 10 trans-mountain diversions in Colorado. Colorado Big Thompson's just one of them.
Okay.
There are a number of them. So anyway, that was going on at the time of 1929, and that was a lot of the work that I had to do was under the umbrella of the Boulder Canyon Project Act and dealing with the rights of people and that sort of thing, and interpreting that act in regard to the dispute going on between IID and MWD. That was just a good example, that particular dispute, of the kinds of legal issues that came up all the time in regard to water rights and management of the river that the Bureau of Reclamation would bring to our office. They also had a lot of hydropower issues, and we had lawyers who were assigned to that task, and contracting issues, you know, and building things and maintaining things and that sort of thing, and lawyers were assigned to that. I worked in the solicitor's office for about 18 years, and for the last 3 years or 4 years, something like that, I was the field solicitor. The field solicitor retired, and I was named the successor, and so I managed the office of about 7 lawyers. And at that point in time, that was about 1993 or 92, something like that, the CAP was largely getting finished. Things had settled down between IID and MWD temporarily. Nevada was getting moving on its problems because it was growing into its entitlement and getting nervous about how much water it had and that sort of thing. And then there was some stuff going on with the CAP where there was litigation over some dam proposals, and we had to resolve some changes in the project development. Congress legislated again on the CAP and changed some of the structure of the CAP. So
there was some dams like Orm weren't built. And
yeah,
is that what we're talking about?
That's right.
Okay.
Orm Dam was originally authorized, and they provided a substitute, which turned out to be what's called Waddell Dam. But they also had a second dam on the Verde River that was going to be constructed, and they decided not to build that dam after some litigation. So that was the kind of work that I was doing, but I was still working on the Indian matters as well. And the Indian matters really got heated up because of these adjudications. There was adjudications on the Salt River in Arizona, the Gila River, the Verde River, and that sort of thing. And what happened in about the mid-1980s was that we started negotiating Indian water rights settlements. And that all depended upon the motivation of a tribe to want to settle instead of litigate their rights. And a number of tribes kind of lined up saying, we're interested in negotiating rather than litigating. So we started working on these settlements. So at the same time I was representing the Bureau of Reclamation doing all this Colorado River stuff, I was also doing Indian water rights settlements. And I think one of the first ones we did was Ak Chin, which is down south of Phoenix. And we the importance of an Indian water rights settlement is that there's so much ambiguity in the law about what the tribes can do and what they own, what they don't own, and all of that, that you really need federal legislation. Because Indian tribes, even though they call themselves nations, are not really nations. You know, nations have armies and generate currency and engage in foreign affairs and that sort of thing. Indian tribes are called domestic dependent sovereigns. So they have a certain sovereignty, but they aren't nations. And the land of Indian reservations is owned by the United States, all of it. And so the water that is part of the land, the water right, is owned by the United States. And the United States has to be the real party in interest in that kind of litigation. And so I was the guy who was the chief lawyer for the Department of Interior litigating all of these Indian rights. Now, I, of course, had Justice Department lawyers who were trial lawyers who were involved in that process. But I was the one who primarily put together the claims, understood the facts, did a lot of arguing in court and presenting the materials in court and that sort of thing during the process of these adjudications. and then also worked on the settlements as far as the settlement agreements and the legislation.
In talking about these adjudications, is it correct to state that whatever water is provided to an Indian tribe off of the Colorado River,
right,
ascribes to the state's entitlement?
Correct.
If Arizona has 2.8 million on the Colorado,
right,
and the Indian water right is determined to be 100,000, that comes out of the 2.8, is
correct.
That correct?
Yeah, absolutely. And it's important to understand that some of those reservations straddle the border. So in other words, the Colorado River Indian Reservation is mostly in Arizona, but partly in California. Fort Mojave is in Arizona, California, and Nevada. It has lands in all three states. Water rights in all three states. So the water rights for those reservations were litigated in Arizona versus California 1, and they were determined by decree in 1964, following the decision in 1963. So we understood at that point the water rights of those reservations. And in Arizona, if you add up Quishan, Colorado River Indian Reservation, Arizona Territory, and Fort Mojave and some other little ones, the amount of water was about 700,000 acre feet. The total amount litigated or adjudicated to those tribes was about 900,000 acre feet, almost a million acre feet, just to the Indian tribes, but about 700,000 in Arizona. So the 700,000 comes out of the 2.8. So that leaves 2.1 for the non-Indians in Arizona. It's a very important aspect of the law of the river. The other reservations that I'm talking about were interior to Arizona: Salt River, Fort McDowell, San Carlos, White Mountain Apache. We also worked on Navajo and Hopi and that sort of thing. So that took up a lot of my time for a number of years, because some of these settlements took about 8 years or 7 or 8 years or 6 years to negotiate, and to then run the legislation through Congress and to get appropriations and to then run the adjudication settlement through a court. So that was part of what I was doing during that time. In addition, I was just doing regular reclamation law, and toward the end of my time at Interior, I left the department in 1996. Toward the end, the Bureau of Reclamation decided that they wanted to try and educate people more about the Colorado River. So they asked me to put together kind of a, and I think you're probably familiar with this name, but the guy's name is Milt Nathanson, who used to work in the solicitor's office in Los Angeles when they had an LA solicitor's office. And the Blue Book, which is the Law of the River documents, which was the updated version of the Hoover Dam documents put together by Northcutt Ely and whoever else it was. But the update to that was written by Milt Nathanson and compiled by Milt. So he was a very knowledgeable guy, and he had a lot to do with Arizona versus California and the development of the CAP and you know, all of that. But he used to give sort of these Law of the River briefings, and once he was gone, the Bureau didn't have that anymore, so they asked me to do that. So I put together a kind of a summary of the Law of the River, an outline that I could cover in, depending upon the time that was allotted, an hour or 2 hours or 3 hours, whatever
or a week and a
people
half.
Had time for, or a week and a half. And so from time to time, they would have public meetings, and they would have an agenda, and they would have as part of it explanation of the Law of the River. And I would get up there for an hour and a half or something like that and give people an outline and try and run them through the law, you know, and start just as I did with you, with the flooding and the population growth and the compact and the 1929 Act and then the treaty with Mexico and then, you know, on and on and on. And so I kind of got good at summarizing this whole Law of the River history. So when I left the solicitor's office, one of the things that I did pretty quickly thereafter, and I've done it about 4 times if I can remember, and frankly I continue to push myself to do it again because it's really a public service, and that is I would put on a day-long seminar on the Law of the Colorado River. and I would have an outline covering that entire 100-year period. And in the morning of this day-long session, we would cover that outline. So we would spend 4 hours on it. Not 1 hour, but 4 hours. And then we'd take a break for lunch, and we would come back. And in the early afternoon, we'd apply it to some examples. We'd look at the operation of Glen Canyon Dam and, you know, how that fits into the Colorado River and what kinds of problems there are, and transfers like IID to MWD, problems with Nevada, that sort of thing. And then in the late afternoon, I would just take questions, and people would have endless questions, I mean, just on and on. And it was really a good thing, and I would always get 200 or 250 people at these seminars, and I usually did it at this law school in San Diego. And when you think about it, all these people have some connection to the river, but they don't know anything about it. It's like you working at MWD. You brought on new employees who were supposed to do things. I don't care whether it's a Bill Hazenkamp or somebody else who comes on, who, you know, they're given much in the way of training about the law of the river. Or let's say you're a new council member at the Colorado River Indian Tribe. You're sitting on a water right of 750,000 acre feet, and you don't know anything about the law of the river. Or let's say you're the new assistant city manager at Yuma, and part of your job description is management of Colorado River entitlement. Well, Yuma's got 50,000 acre feet. What do they do with it? How's it managed? How is it spread out? What you know, have they used it all? Have they not? How does it work with their development and everything else? And so there's just so many people, CAP, Southern Nevada Water Authority, MWD, San Diego, Phoenix, Tucson. I mean, all of these people would send people to these seminars, and they were always so grateful. Fish and Wildlife Service, National Park Service, Bureau of Reclamation. They were always so grateful because it gave them a foundation upon which to make sense out of their particular deal. If you were involved with the CAP, it really helped to see the history, and then the 1968 Act and how the CAP is structured. Why is the CAP junior in priority to California? Nobody understands that unless you go through the statutory process and have them read the statute. You know, and I would have a big notebook with all this stuff in it, and I really believe in that. I really believe in having people read the words. You know, I want them to read what Congress says. The Secretary is hereby authorized to construct at Black Canyon a high dam, you know, and blah, 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 and a canal that will be all in the United States that starts at Laguna Dam or suitable alternative, which turned out to be Imperial Dam. You know, I want them to read the words. I want them to read where they say the Secretary is authorized to construct the Central Arizona Project, which will be made up of the following things. And then you know, you go through these various statutes. I will give you an example of how important some of these statutory matters are, and that is the when we talked about the upper basin versus the lower basin. At some point, the upper basin became very frustrated when it came to the Colorado River. They had protected themselves with the compact, and so they were satisfied with that, but
the 1922
compact.
Okay.
But 30 years went by, and they didn't get any real benefits. And they looked downstream, and they said, "Gee, the lower basin's got Hoover Dam, the All America Canal, Imperial Dam. Now they've got Parker Dam in Lake Havasu, and they've got Mojave because it was built for treaty water regulation for the Mexican Water Treaty." They've got the aqueduct to MWD, and now there's talk about a Central Arizona project, you know, in the early 50s. And they were saying, well, we're like the stepchild, you know, who hasn't gotten any benefits. So they go complaining to Congress, and in 1956, Congress passes the Colorado River Storage Project Act, and they authorized four big units, they call them. First was Curacante, which was on the Gunnison and Colorado rivers, and that's later been called the Aspinall Unit. Next was Navajo, which was Navajo Dam on the San Juan. Next was Flaming Gorge on the Green River coming down from Wyoming. And then finally, Glen Canyon. You know, that's where Glen Canyon came from, was the 1956 Act. And the 1956 Act was passed before NEPA and the Endangered Species Act. So no wonder that Glen Canyon Dam caused so much damage. I mean, after Glen Canyon Dam, the flow of the Colorado below Morelos Dam in Mexico flatlined. It went to zero. If you look at the flows below Morelos on a chart, you know, you can see the river doing all kinds of things in 1920s, you know, 15 million acre feet, 20 million acre feet going to the ocean. And then about 1929, the chart goes down a bit because they closed the gates of Hoover and they filled Lake Mead. But still, one lake wasn't big enough to hold the river. So there was always flows to Mexico and more than Mexico could use. But they closed the gates at Glen Canyon, and now there's no more river other than the water that goes to Mexico for the treaty, and the river was dry below Morelos. So Glen Canyon really dried up the delta.
And Glen Canyon, of course, formed Lake Powell.
Lake Powell, yeah. So anyway, in the 56 Act, the Congress, in its wisdom, in Section 7, and this is part of what I would do to show the students how all this stuff comes together, in Section 7, the Congress said, you shall run the hydropower units of all of these dams at full capacity. You will generate as much power as you can. And that was the command of Section 7. And so how did they then run Glen Canyon? Well, they ran it totally in a peaking power way so that at 5 o'clock in the morning, they would let out 5,000 cubic feet per second. Because in July, things were cooler, you know, in Las Vegas and Phoenix and southern Utah and wherever that power was going. And at 3 o'clock in the afternoon, or 5 o'clock in the afternoon, they would let out 40,000 cubic feet per second. So the river was going up and down like a yo-yo. And it was washing out sandbars and washing out trees and washing out archaeological things and all of that stuff. So it was creating a lot of problems. And the poor recreationalists, the boatmen, would come in for the evening at 5 o'clock and park their boats, you know, and lash them to a tree or something like that. And when they would go to leave in the morning, their boats would be, 200 feet from the river because the river had gone down. And it was, you know, it was a fifth of what it was, you know, in the late afternoon. So anyway, that's when Congress was motivated through the leadership of John McCain to pass the Grand Canyon Protection Act, which is what we deal with now, which is a complicated, hard-to-understand act about the reoperation of Glen Canyon Dam and the development of an EIS to look at alternatives for the operation of Glen Canyon. And basically what it did, even though some attorneys disagree with this, they modified, in my opinion, Section 7 of that 56 Act and said you will reoperate it and you will take care of the resources downstream of the dam. So it basically cut back hydropower production. So they now had a much smaller range within which to fluctuate the releases from the dam. And we're still on that path. I mean, 2 days ago I was at an AMWIG meeting, and AMWIG is the Adaptive Management Work Group, which was set up under the Grand Canyon Protection Act to advise the Secretary about these downstream resources and the operation of Glen Canyon Dam. And it's an incredible thing. I mean, there's 50 people in the room, and they're representing all these interests, the seven states, the hydropower people, the recreationists, the environmentalists, the Department of Interior, Park Service, you know, everybody, all trying to understand this river and especially figure out what to do with the giant dam that's above the Grand Canyon. So it's a very complicated, frustrating process.
It must be frustrating to know and be party to a large group like that when you know that a large percentage of them don't have a clue what they're talking about.
No, a lot of them are not well educated when it comes to the law of the river. And let me just say again, back to this thing about teaching the law, I have been invited everywhere to do this. So once people kind of got wind of it, they started reaching out to me. And so, for example, there is an organization of the Colorado River guides, the guys who do the rafting and, you know, and the boatmen. Yeah. It's a boatman's organization. And they have a once a year gathering, and a couple of times I've been invited up there to give a talk on the law of the river, to try and educate these guides about just the law of the river so that they would understand it better, because they're always talking to their clients who, you know, and that sort of thing. I have gone to give law of the river talks probably 3 or 4 times to the Bureau of Reclamation, solely the Bureau, and they'll fill an auditorium with employees, and I'll explain the law to them. I've done it 3 or 4 times for the National Park Service. The Park Service has a water rights office that they do most of their water rights out of up in Colorado for the southwestern region of the Park Service, and then they also have a Colorado River drainage organization of superintendents that gets together quite frequently just to talk about issues in their territory having to do with the river, and I would go talk to these guys and explain the law of the river, and I've done it in a number of different places. I do it somewhat frequently down at IID, as you can imagine. They get a new general manager or some new employee of one form or another, and I'll go down there, and sometimes their division chiefs will say, hey, I've got enough new people where I'll fill a room with 25 people, and we'll do a law of the river for a half a day, something like that. So I do it somewhat frequently for California, for IID.
Let's, in looking at, I want to wrap up your work with Interior. Over the course of that 18 years, is there a particular highlight or lowlight that jumps out at you as, you know, that was a law worth working on, or perhaps that's the one you've already talked about?
Well, I guess I've talked about a number of things that happened in regard to the Colorado River. I mean, obviously there were big deals like Arizona versus California, and we were involved with Arizona versus California 2, where it had to do with the boundaries of Indian reservations and litigation in the Supreme Court. I was fortunate at my time in the solicitor's office, probably 5 or 6 cases out of our office went to the Supreme Court, which is largely unheard of. You know, when if you're in a law firm, maybe one case goes to the Supreme Court if you're lucky. So we had things at the high level of adjudication a lot, but. One of the things that was a particular memory, and I know you talked to Bob Johnson about this, was that the Bureau decided at one point that they needed some regulations, especially to regulate illegal pumping along the river. That it was getting to a point where that was getting out of control, and there were too many users along the river who were pumping out of the shallow aquifer, and they were authorized to drill these wells by the states. And the states weren't doing a good job of saying, you know, you really can't pump there because you're pumping the subflow of the river. They would just say, go ahead, you know, you've got, you're a landowner, you got the right to drill a well. So the Bureau said, we've got to step in. And in Arizona versus California's decisions from the Supreme Court, it talks about the mainstream or water taken from the subsurface by underground pumping. So there's clearly jurisdiction over that subflow of the river. So they wanted to draft regulations to finally stop that. And you've got to put together something that's kind of a due process. You have to say, you're on the river, you've got 2 wells, we're giving you notice that we've studied this, that you're pumping subflow, you don't have a contract, you're an illegal user, we're telling you that you need to stop using the water, you need to cease and desist. We're going to give you an opportunity for a hearing. We'll make a decision. You can appeal that to higher in the department, that sort of thing, and eventually you can take it to court if you want to. So we had to put together a set of regulations, draft regulations, that would do that. Now, for good or for bad, we got on a slippery slope because the Bureau said, you know, we've got other problems. I mean, we've got contracting problems where not everybody on the river who's got a water right has a contract. So we ought to put in some regulations about contracting. And then we've got problems with people moving water rights. They want to transfer them from one point to another. So we ought to put in some regulations about that. And then we've got problems with this or that. I mean, they had about 6 or 8 or 10 issues. And we just kept rolling. And so we would write these different sections of proposed regulations. that frankly were very good. And I don't mean to say that just because I was involved in drafting them. And I drafted most of the sections. I would run off real fast and draft whole section regulations and then bring it back to the regional director who was sitting in the office and the assistant regional director and a couple of other attorneys from my office. And we would all edit these sections, and eventually we would refine them down to a pretty good product. At least we thought it was good. Then these went up to the top of the department, and they said, you know, looks okay, you know, put them out for public comment. But we had some unusual stuff in there. We got off onto interstate transfers, and we were authorizing the interstate transfer of water. We were authorizing the wheeling of water. I mean, let's say San Diego went to Utah and found some groundwater source that wasn't connected to the river and pumps it over to the river and wants to wheel it from up there down to MWD's intake. Well, we provided for wheeling. We provided for interstate transfers and all kinds of things. And we thought we did it legally correctly. But when they went out for public comment, we just got a firestorm of protest. Now, nobody really protested the thing about the illegal users in that process. They all thought that was pretty good. Or simple things like managing the contracting process or something like that. But it was the more exotic stuff that they didn't like. Interstate transfers and wheeling and other things that we put in there that I can't recall right now. And, for example, CAP had real problems with it. The state of Arizona had real problems. I'm sure that California, Colorado River Board had issues. And so they uniformly got shouted down. And the department generally put those on the back burner and said, well, we'll get to them later and maybe we'll refine them and maybe we'll do something. And they just kind of let them sit. When I was talking to Bob Johnson briefly in the hall, we were agreeing that those regulations, in fact, were the catalyst of a lot of activity that came along thereafter. It got people to thinking about a number of these matters, about interstate transfers, about how you can make that kind of thing work under the decree, about interstate banking of water, that sort of thing. And it was about that time also, to use an example, that Nevada was really kicking up the dust. Nevada was rattling the saber in saying, we're going to reopen Arizona versus California or something. We're going to do
what,
something.
What year are we talking about?
Oh,
roughly.
Probably 94, 95. And we're going to reopen things, because we're unhappy with our entitlement. We got screwed. We only got 300,000 acre feet, and you guys got, you know, big shares of the river. And so they were actually talking in that direction. And as a result of these regulations and the thinking about it, we talked to them and said, you know, we just think you guys are missing the boat. First of all, you're not going to succeed in reallocating. You ought to think about diversifying. You know, you've got to think about getting other supplies. You could even build a desalting plant over by Los Angeles and do an exchange with MWD. I mean, you can do a lot of things if you just think about, you know, your resources and what you can do. And maybe there are some things on the river that can happen. And I don't remember whether we talked about banking necessarily, but we just said, you know, be creative. And I think thereafter, Nevada really went in that direction, and that's why they went to appropriate the groundwater in the northern part of the state and bring a pipeline down. That's why they got so interested in interstate banking with Arizona and helped develop federal regulations. That's why now, in recent years, they have helped construct Drop 2 Reservoir and gotten water out of that. They've done a lot of things to diversify their supply and to make things better for Nevada without going back and trying to redo the law of the river. So I think that a lot of good came out of those draft regulations without them ever being promulgated. They still ought to be promulgated to some degree, and they have been, because they've put out some draft regulations on stopping illegal pumping. But even those haven't been put into final regulations because there's been controversy about certain aspects of those regs, which is unfortunate because they really need to be put into place. So anyway, I don't know whether I've answered your question. I've really gone on too long here, but those were some of the high points in my time with Interior. And then I left in 1996.
Okay, I think this is a perfect place to stop this particular tape because we're almost out of tape, and then we'll pick this up on the next one and get to the second phase
okay.
of your career.
Good.
Bill Swan in Phoenix, Arizona, February the 5th, 2010. Bill, with the knowledge that you can do 2 or 3 or 5 or 8 hours on the Law of the River, which isn't the purpose of this particular project, we kind of wrapped up your time at Interior as an attorney. Let's move on. You left Interior and you went to work for a private law firm, I presume. I know that you do a lot of work for Imperial Irrigation District, but I also know that you're not an employee of Imperial
right.
Irrigation District. So how did you evolve out of Interior?
It's sort of interesting that when I will tell you this story, even though I don't think a lot of people know this story. When I decided to leave Interior, I just was burned out. I didn't retire. I didn't have enough years to retire. Probably should have stayed to retire in hindsight, but I just decided to leave, and I had as sort of mentors a number of different people that I used to talk to who had been in private practice and of some form or another, attorneys or engineers or whatever, and I talked to these guys. Don Glazer, who used to be an assistant to the Commissioner for Bureau of Reclamation, Dennis Underwood, who you know well, Mike Clinton, who I think you know well, and a couple of other guys. And I would just talk to these guys about going into private practice and how it would work and all that. And at the time, Mike Clinton was the general manager of IID, and they were starting to work on the transfer to San Diego at about that time. And so there was a lot of conversation between IID and San Diego. And I never in my mind thought about doing work for IID. It just hadn't come to me. I thought, you know, I might do some work for CAP or whatever, even though I'm licensed to practice law in California. I could be an advisor or whatever. But I got an idea, and I called Mike Clinton one day, and I said, I've got an idea, and that is, I think San Diego is going to become much more involved in the Colorado River. And at the time, they were not. If you remember correctly, it was really just MWD. It wasn't any of the sub-agencies under MWD. And I said, I think they're going to become more involved in the Colorado River, and I think they could use representation, and maybe they would be interested in my services. And Mike said, that's a great idea. You're right. Good idea. I'll talk to him. I talk to him frequently. I'll talk to the general manager, and I'll let you know. So 2 or 3 weeks later, he calls me back, and he says, I got some good news and some bad news. And I said, what's the bad news? He says, they're not interested. I said, what's the good news? And he said, we are. So I went and met with John Carter, who was chief counsel at the time, and we talked about a relationship where I would do work for IID, and we entered into an agreement. I was not associated with a law firm at the time. I was just working on my own, and I had an office here in Phoenix, and I figured I would just do work for a variety of different interests that had to do with water law and environmental law, which I had done a lot of, Colorado River, whatever. And when I started out, I probably did about 30% of my work for IID, something like that. But it slowly grew rather quickly to where much more and more of my time was devoted to IID and less time that I had for clients like the Salt River Project and certain Indian tribes and that sort of thing that I was doing work with. So things got busier and busier with IID, and then as we moved from the 90s into the early 2000s, we got much deeper into the transfer to San Diego, fighting over that with Coachella and MWD, the beginnings of the conversation of a QSA, and that sort of thing. And so starting about 2001, I was spending 100% of my time on IID work. And What I have basically done for IID since then is just a giant variety of things. I mean, I work on all kinds of things for IID, Endangered Species Act stuff, NEPA, Colorado River water rights. They've got a power plant on the Yuma side of the river that needs a good water supply. I mean, there's just sort of an endless number of things that are going on, including even attending this recent AMWG meeting because they're talking about reoperating Glen Canyon Dam. IID, big users like IID and MWD, keep an eye on Glen Canyon operations because Glen Canyon at Lake Powell holds 25 million acre feet. When you use 3 million acre feet a year, you know, 25 million acre feet is a lot of water, but Lake Mead's half empty right now. So, or half full.
Well, both Lake Powell and Lake Mead are
close to half. I mean, Powell's at about 60% or 65, something like that. But, you know, IID alone could drain Mead in about 4 years. You know, so IID has a big interest in the whole river. And as a matter of fact, we keep track of things going on in Colorado and transbasin diversions and, you know, all that stuff. How soon will the upper basin grow into its entitlement and, you know, those kinds of problems. I mean, could there be a call on the river by the lower basin to the upper basin under the compact and that sort of thing? So it's a wide-ranging area of matters that I work on.
Let me ask you a question. This is going to go to certainly a portion of your program on the law of the river, and I don't want you to get too deeply into it, but it's a question that I've never asked any of the other interviewees, and I think you're uniquely qualified to answer it. Most of the agencies, if not all, are scared to death that the Bureau of Reclamation, Department of Interior, will at some point in time declare shortages on the Colorado River. Now, we're in the 7th or 8th or 9th year of drought, depending
right.
on when you start talking. And to many lay people, they go, well, yeah, it's, you know, Mead and Powell are together only about half what they should have. If you're not going to declare a shortage now, when do you? Can you discuss, if you would, for a minute, what's the trauma? Why are water agencies, Arizona, California, Nevada specifically, scared to death about that word, declaring
right.
a shortage on the Colorado River, which has never been done?
I will do that. Let me say, first of all, how beautiful the system works. Look at it. We've been through about 10 years of drought, and the system is more than half full. So it's incredible. I mean, it really does work. So compared to someplace like Seattle that's got little reservoirs that empty quickly, and they've got it, they're dependent upon rainfall, or the East Coast, or the South, or whatever, we have these giant canyons that we can fill with water. Lake Mead and Lake Powell, they're the largest man-made reservoirs in the country. So they're really huge, and they really work. And then combined with all the other reservoirs, there's 60 million acre feet of reservoir storage. That's five or four times the river flow, the annual river flow. So we have much more carryover storage than any other place in the country. So it really does work. It's a marvelous system, and it's worked well throughout this drought. There hasn't been a declaration of a shortage. But as we got closer to the problem of a shortage, it was decided by the secretary that either they were going to create some guidelines having to do with shortage, or they would let the states primarily do it. And they set up a process, a NEPA process, to arrive at some guidelines. The states then put together a proposal for not only some guidelines on shortage, but the reoperation of Lake Powell and Lake Mead, and some other things. And they presented that to the government, and the government accepted that with minor modifications as the preferred alternative and put those into formal guidelines. Now, let's focus on just the shortage part of it for a second. What does it say about shortages? And the key to that is to go back to the 1968 Act. In the 1968 Act, which California did not want to approve, they didn't want to see the CAP constructed, California extracted a pound of flesh, actually 2 pounds of flesh. They said that the CAP will be junior to all of California's apportionment. And then secondly, they confined the size of the aqueduct. They made it about 2,500 cubic feet per second. So it's a little aqueduct. It's not a big aqueduct. I don't know whether you know this or not, but where the All-American Canal takes off from the Colorado River, the capacity is 15,000 cubic feet per second. That is a gigantic amount of water. Shortly thereafter, some is siphoned back over to Yuma. Then some goes to Mexico. Then, of course, you have the Coachella branch and that sort of thing. And about into the valley, you have 8 or 10,000 cubic feet per second. But 15,000 cubic feet per second is what you see going through the Grand Canyon when people are rafting, you know, and the river's bouncing around. That's about 15,000 cubic feet per second, and that's flowing in the Southern California desert. So 2,500 cubic feet per second is a small aqueduct. And so CAP has always been unhappy about the way things worked out. But because of that, they are junior. Now, we talked about Arizona having 2.8 million acre feet. About 700,000 goes to Indians, okay? 1.3 of the 2.8 is left over beyond the CAP. So out of that 1.3 comes the 700,000 Indian tribes, and then the rest goes to non-Indians in the Yuma area and elsewhere along the river. But about 1.5 million acre feet is designed to go to the CAP. So the CAP is junior to California. So the other thing that happens is that everybody who's post 1968 is lumped together as being junior. So in Arizona, there was some unallocated water out of the 2.8 in 1968. And they allocated over on the river about 166,000 acre feet. Lake Havasu City, the Mojave Irrigation District, other latecomer users, okay? And some of the uses in Nevada are post-68. So when it comes to the law, if you declare a shortage, and I'll get to how that happens, the ones that are cut back first are CAP, Nevada, and the Arizona users along the river with the junior rights, the post-68 rights, not the Yuma guys. They're all senior. So you know who's going to take the hit first. We know that. And it's not California. So you had to figure out when the shortage would be declared. So these guidelines say, according to reservoir elevations, when Lake Mead gets to 1075 or something like that elevation, that will be the first cut shortage. And the amount of shortage will be 300,000 acre feet or something like that to CAP, 30,000 acre feet to Nevada, and, you know, something like that. The amounts are actually set forth in the guidelines. So CAP knows how much it's going to be shorted. Now, if the reservoir goes lower to about 1050 or whatever, there's a second stage of shortage. And then CAP, it's cut back a larger amount, 400,000 or something like that. And then the third stage of shortage, and CAP's cut back about 500,000. Now, CAP is cut into sort of three big sections. Non-Indian agriculture, Indian water rights, and municipal industrial. Now, it's the municipal industrial and the Indian that's about a million acre feet or a million one, something like that. And the non-Indian agriculture was always thought to be kind of expendable. It was a junior priority. CAP was the first big Bureau of Reclamation M&I project. Everything else had been agriculture, if you think about it. So the ag guys are junior. So they get cut back, and things like groundwater recharge gets cut back and that sort of thing. So it's not a terrible pound of flesh for Arizona until you get past that kind of 400,000 or 500,000 acre feet mark, because then you start getting into the Indian entitlements and the M&I, and they tend to share that proportionally. So once you start cutting back the M&I uses in Arizona, now you've got a real problem. Now what's Arizona likely to do? They're likely to go to the Yuma area and get temporary water supplies and fallow farmland and bring that in through the CAP. There's about 800,000 acre feet in the Yuma area. So do they have a fallback? They do, as long as Yuma doesn't turn into 2 million people. But at least for now, they've got agriculture to turn to. Now, in regard to the shortage, how draconian or how painful is it? Well, it is very painful. as shortages go, and as the secretary has to follow the law, he has to take CAP to zero before he starts on any of the California rights. Now, you might have a California right. All of the California rights are pretty senior, but I mean, let's say Coachella or some of the small PP, smaller rights along the river or something else could get cut back if you start into the 4.4. The most junior right, obviously, is MWD. And so then you start into MWD's entitlement if you start cutting into the 4.4. So very significant impact in California immediately because you're cutting back M&I water, not agriculture. But in regard to these guidelines, they only go down about 500,000 acre feet. They don't go down 1.5 million. In other words, it doesn't provide the elimination of the entire CAP. There wasn't the fortitude. There wasn't the wherewithal. There wasn't the political power or impetus to go further than that. What it says, the guidelines say this, once the reservoir gets down to about 1025 or something like that, and it's supposed to be held at 1,000, and at 1,000, one of the Nevada intakes is sucking wind. So 1,000 is very, very serious as far as an elevation. And I don't know the acre feet that are in the reservoir at 1,000, but it's very low. But I think at about 1025, the regulations say the parties will consult. Now, here's an editorial comment for you. Okay? What does that mean? That means that the Department of Interior will sit down with all the big users, and they will talk about what's going to happen next. And, of course, California will say, I'm really sorry about this, but Arizona, you got to take the hit. And Nevada, you too. That's the law. And California will stand on its rights. There's no doubt in my mind. But a second thing will happen in my mind. And this is not helpful to my client, but I will say it anyway. And that is, there will be what I call the conspiracy of the urbans. You will have CAP, the city of Phoenix, the city of Tucson, MWD, San Diego, and the Southern Nevada Water Authority all getting together in a room saying, what are we going to do? We're now getting into municipal industrial cutbacks, and we can't stomach that. We can't handle it. It's too difficult to cover M&I losses, and we think it's foolish, and you can hear this coming from Nevada. We think it's foolish when on an acre of our land on the Nevada Strip creates $1 billion in revenue, and the entire Imperial Valley creates $1 billion in revenue. We think it's foolish to let guys irrigate when we're short of water. So there will be tremendous power or pressure on Yuma, Palo Verde, IID, even Coachella. Coachella has a lot of permanent crops, so that's going to be difficult. But there's going to be pressure on those irrigation districts to do something. So a shortage of greater magnitude is going to be a big deal. But to answer your question succinctly, the shortage guidelines are in place. We now know what's going to happen down to a certain reservoir elevation. And if it goes below that, then people have to consult and try and figure out where further to go. So it really is something that's understood. Let me, in the little time that's left, explain what I have also done with IID. As we got into about 2002, the QSA really started to heat up. And I was very much involved as part of the IID team, of creating the QSA, the QSA documents, providing for environmental compliance, just all of it. Oftentimes, I was not necessarily on the front lines of negotiation. Oftentimes, it would be John Carter and David Osias and Rodney Smith who might go to some negotiation meeting. But I was oftentimes, for example, in Sacramento working on legislation. And I had a lot to do with the QSA legislation. I was back and forth to Sacramento once or twice a week for a couple of years. And for the years 2002, 2003, 2004, I worked you know, 70-hour weeks because we just had so much to do. I mean, we worked on Sundays. So the QSA took a huge amount of time.
We should say, just if you don't know, QSA is the Quantification Settlement Agreement, which in effect allowed for additional ag to urban transfers.
Correct. And what it really did was provided for the quantification temporarily of the IID entitlement and the Coachella entitlement. So there could be transfers and you could account for them in a way where you had the fixed amount of 3.1 to IID and you can deduct from that, as opposed to IID having an elastic water right, which it had beforehand, where it could go up and down. And so when you then try and subtract water like the 105,000 to MWD, sometimes people would question whether it's in Arizona or someplace else. Is that really being saved because IID's use is going up and down? Well, the water was probably no doubt being saved because conservation measures were in the ground and actually saving the water. But IID had a flexible water right. So by having a fixed water right, it's the accounting is much more reliable.
Did that make the pardon me, did that make the second negotiation for ag to urban transfer, and I'm now talking about IID to San Diego.
Yeah.
Did the QSA really facilitated that? Did it not
Absolutely.
Made it possible?
Made it possible. Yeah. Because going back to our conversation about that opinion and the state versus federal law, IID felt that under state law it could transfer to San Diego without any involvement of anybody else. That they could transfer under state law and the beneficial use stayed with IID. So the transfer did not violate the rights of Coachella or MWD. But they relied upon state law to make that point. Now, I've already told you, MWD and Coachella think the river's federalized. So they don't think state law applies. So they say you can't transfer. The saved water would go to me, Coachella, or me, MWD, and it wouldn't get to San Diego. So we just couldn't breach that gap. We had to somehow work out an agreement which provided for the quantification settlement agreement that Coachella and MWD would agree to. And that's what the QSA is all about. It's about providing benefits that go around enough that that everybody would agree to it, and legislation that provided for a number of things. So that's really the QSA.
In the brief time we have left, I'm going to pull this question out of left field because you sort of inspired the question, to be honest with you. I'm not going to ask you anything about current activity with IID. I mean, that would be unfair because I know that you're still actively working with them or for them. But looking backward now, over your entire career, what's the single most difficult negotiation or project that you worked on? I mean, what one stands out in your mind as that was almost impossible?
Yeah, I think it has to be the QSA. Some of the Indian water rights settlements were very difficult, and litigation was going on at the same time. So whenever you're litigating something and trying to settle at the same time, it's double duty. And oftentimes litigation will just be put on hold while somebody works on a settlement. I don't care whether it's Toyota versus Ford or, you know, somebody else. They stop the litigation and they try and work out a settlement. But in these adjudications, it would keep grinding on. And so there was always stuff to be working on and claims to be made and issues to be fought over and all of that stuff and appeals to the Supreme Court. So it was really difficult to do some of those settlements, and those were very hard fought situations and a lot of hard negotiations. But by far the QSA was the most complicated. I mean, I think you know that there are about 40 agreements that make up the QSA. It's exceedingly complicated. It's very hard to implement. IID still works on the implementation. And most people think that the QSA is just sort of finished. Well, it's not. It's the implementation that is really complicated, and they're doing that now. And you know, we have monthly meetings where you'll have five lawyers and five staff people. And we go for a day long going through issues having to do with the implementation of the QSA. It's that complicated. It's that difficult. But anyway, the QSA was the hardest matter. It involved negotiations. It involved at one point litigation against the federal government where they cut back IID's rights. There were very, very antagonistic situations in the QSA. The federal government, unlike past administrations, Babbitt, for example, tried to help negotiate the QSA, but he stayed neutral. He would go to MWD and say, if this doesn't work out, bad things are going to happen to you. And he would go to IID and say, if this doesn't work out, bad things are going to happen to you. He stayed neutral. But the administration of Bennett Raley, they took sides. He sided with the Urbans, and he attacked IID. So he tried to cut back IID's water right administratively by 350,000 acre feet or whatever. We had to sue the government. We got an injunction against them, which was a gigantic victory. But it ground on in the form of an administrative proceeding about IID's reasonable use, and there was just huge litigation over that.
And it continues to grind on today.
Well, we have peace treaties now, and things are better, and they're quieter. IID and MWD don't get along very well because they're just two big gorillas with significant interests, and IID has such a large entitlement, and MWD has such a need with 18 or 19 million people that it just makes sense that there's going to be tension there, and there still is tension. But it was the combination of the negotiations, the legislation, and litigation all at the same time, which made the QSA so complicated and so difficult, and very hard feelings between the federal government and IID, and the state was involved, and they tried to kind of stay neutral. MWD was on the warpath, you know. San Diego was fighting with MWD, and Coachella was against IID, and so the whole thing was a mess. It was very difficult. That was by far the most difficult problem.
One last question in the few minutes we have here, and it involves Arizona v. California.
Sure.
The case is marked either 1963 or 64, depending on whose copy you're reading.
Right.
But it went on.
Right.
Is that over, or is it still
ongoing? It's over. It's over. It's over for now. And let me try and answer this way. 63 was the court's decision. They had accepted the special master's report. They agreed and disagreed with parts of it, but they issued a decision in 63. In 1964, they issued their decree. Now, their decree only covered certain rights, certain Indian rights and National Park Service rights and that sort of thing. They then said, we're directing the parties to go work on a supplemental decree for the present perfected rights. That was worked on over a period of years, and it took longer than the court wanted, but in 1979, they finally issued a supplemental decree that decreed the present perfected rights. So it's that decree that I would go to, and I would show you IID's present perfected right for 2.6 million acre feet, and Palo Verde's right, and Yuma Mesa's right, and the Colorado River Indian tribes are repeated in there, and the miscellaneous rights along the river.
And those are from the early 1900s.
Yeah, pre-1929 rights. Then there was a third opinion that had to do with Indian water rights and boundaries. The problem is that the Indian rights had been adjudicated in Arizona versus California. When the government tried to go in and claim additional rights, the court told them that it was res judicata. It had been litigated and it was over with, and the government had lost its opportunity. But nevertheless, these reservations had been expanded in size because of administrative decisions by the secretary, and there was more irrigable land. So there were negotiations that went on primarily between Arizona, because of the lands on the Arizona side, and MWD and Coachella because of lands on the California side, because the more that you take out of California, the more you affect the junior user, who's MWD. So MWD was very much involved in this litigation, whereas IID was less involved because it was more senior in right. But this all had to be either litigated or negotiated, and they negotiated those settlements, Fort Mojave, Quishon, and Colorado River, and got those settlements in place, and then the court issued a consolidated decree. And so we now have a consolidated decree that covers everything. There is no more Arizona versus California litigation going on. The whole thing is done. Now, when I just said almost finished. The point I would get to is that in Arizona versus California, it only went up to Lake Mead. Now the lower basin is everything below Glen Canyon. So what rights aren't adjudicated? Navajo touches the river. The Grand Canyon National Park straddles the river. The Hualapai Indian Reservation touches the river. The Havasupai Indian Reservation touches the river. All of those rights, one of these days, will have to be adjudicated, or it will be determined that they're lost, the government should have claimed those at the time of Arizona versus California, and the doctrine of res judicata now prohibits their adjudication. I don't think the court would go there, because they just weren't brought up. I mean, they just stopped at Lake Mead. So I just don't think res judicata would be fair to those entities. But someday, unless they're all settled and just taken to the Supreme Court by stipulation, those rights will have to be adjudicated.
Wow.
So Arizona versus California has life left in it, but it's not anything that's anytime soon.
Okay, well, yeah, I'm glad I asked that. That was great. Well, Bill, thank you very much for the time and also for the facilities. It was great.
Sure.
And that concludes this particular oral history with Bill Swan.